Thank you for attending. I'll start the first presentation on scenario-based flood modeling and stochastic optimization of patient evacuation operations during hurricanes. This is a joint work by Operations Research and Industrial Engineering and Jackson School of Geoscience Departments. My name is Kyungyun Kim. I will present the first half of the presentation. This is the second half. I'll present the second half. The first half will be presented by Wen Ying, and then our advisors are Dr. Erhan Kutanoglu, Dr. John Hasenbein, and then Dr. Zong Liang Yang. Could you go to the next slide? When a hurricane is expected to hit the coast and cause flooding, patients and the elderly from hospitals and nursing homes in coastal region evacuates like towards safe inland locations. Such evacuation faces challenges such as uncertain hurricane forecasts, the decision of evacuating routes, and difficulties related to resources. So in this study, we focus our attention to two areas of this particular topic. First is performing the statistical modeling of coastal and the inland flooding. The current approach in flood modeling lacks probabilistic approach in flood generation. We want to show that probabilistic approach in flood generation provides more comprehensive view in flood forecasting. And the second half is to create an optimization framework of patient evacuation operation. And Wen Ming will start the first half of the presentation.
Thank you, Kyung. My name is Wen Ming, and I'm a PhD student in Jackson School of Geoscience. And our job in this project is to modeling the inland flooding. So I will explain the part of the inland flooding in our scenario generation scheme. Beside the inland flooding, we use a storm surge model to modeling the coastal flooding. But today I'm going to focus on the inland flooding part. So here's our methodology for the inland flooding simulation. We run a simulation on tech machine on STEMB2. For the first part, we utilize the real-time weather forecast as our modeling input. For example, variables such as precipitation, temperature, and wind speed, which is very important for hurricane forecast. And then the hydrology model we are running are called Wolf Hydro, or maybe here it is called National Water Model. So our study domain is the Texas Gulf region. Here we have 60,000 river reaches. And the final output of the National Water Model that we use is the streamflow time series. And then we also use the hydraulic from Paula and Dr. Debbie Maidman team. What they developed it, it's called HAND. And HAND stands for Height Above Nearest Drainage. So based on the stream flow that we got from the National Water Model, and HAND give us the information of the topology. So we can get the water level anytime, anywhere. And that's how we estimate the inland flooding. And then I'm going to show some sample of the output. So at the left-hand side, you can see the dynamic of the stream flows over the Texas Gulf region. And then if you over that with the topology, you can estimate where it's going to be flooded and where it's not. So for the HAND value, because that is the elevation that is above the drainage, so we can estimate any location that is safe or unsafe. And that location in this case will be any hospital or nursing home. And since we are doing the case study for the Hurricane Harvey, and we utilize the uncertainty of the hurricane track to generate the scenario, or you can call the ensemble forecast. The figure you can see over here, the shaded part or the circle, is not the location of the hurricane or the size of the hurricane, but actually it's the uncertainty of the hurricane center. So the cone uncertainty represents the NHC average track error over the past 5 years. And we utilize that for our scenario generation method. So first we define the coastlines with piecewise linear function with two segments as a green line showing here. And during the hurricane landfall, we assume that there is no more random variable distributed along this coastline. So we determine the landfall in this orange point, and then we separated them into 25 points along this red line, and for each 25 points it represents a deterministic simulation and natural water model, and then we just assume that they are equal variability and sample all of them. So for example, there are 25 of that scenario. So there is number one is starting from the southwest, and then the 25 will end over here. So you can imagine that the scenario number one can have very barely no rainfall in the Houston region that we are studying at. However, in scenario 13 and 25, we are able to shift the precipitation in the location that we are interested. And as a result, it will represent the inundation extent from different scenario. For example, here I show the inundation extent from the East Fork of San Jacinto River, which is approximated over somewhere over here, where's the upstream of the Houston area or the northern eastern part of the Houston. And you can see that from the scenario L1, there is barely no inundation extent, but there is a lot of inundation in scenario 13 and 25. And here I also put the USGS FEMA estimation inundation over here to show that the inundation extent is not too far away from what they estimate. And since we are looking at the hospital and the nursing home, so we are able to estimate is the hospital flooded or not. And here's an example of the Brace Bio. So Brace Bio is located in the Houston urban area. There are several hospital and nursing home clustered in one river reach. Here the gray color bar represent the flood level. So any darker color mean there are larger flood level. And here I color code the hospital in solid or hollow. If anyone is that is a black solid dots, which mean that the hospital is flooded in this scenario. So here you can see our results from the inland flooding, and I will turn the presentation to Kim.
Sorry, it was muted. Thank you, Wenning. In the next half of the presentation, I will present the implementation of the generated scenarios to the stochastic optimization model with recourse to provide the operational patient evacuation plan. Next slide, please. The basic operation of the model is to assign vehicles from staging area to evacuating hospital and to safe hospital, then back to staging area, either on path or arc, so that we evacuate patients and elderly from hospitals and nursing homes. Here we provide two different types of formulation, the arc-based and the path-based formulation for evacuation, the patient evacuation model, where the objective is to minimize the total expected cost. In the first stage, we determine the number and the location of the vehicles, the emergency medical vehicles, and the staging area locations. And these decisions are not scenario specific, meaning they should satisfy all scenarios. The vehicle assignments and routing decisions are the scenario specific decisions that we make in the second stage. Set of constraints on demand, capacity, the flow balance, vehicles, and staging areas are introduced to describe the patient evacuation operation that takes place before hurricane. And here, the flow balance, the first two rows are flow balance constraints. Then the next row is the max number of ambulances. Then the rest of them are the vehicle flow and the staging area location decisions. Next slide. Okay, so the first experiment is done in our study region. The region is called the Catastrophic Medical Operations Center region, the CMOC, which consists of 25 counties in Southeast Texas. We use the data from the Homeland Infrastructure Foundation level data, and demand and capacity of the hospitals are calculated by multiplying certain weights to their bed counts. We set 125 evacuating hospitals and 20 receiving hospitals which are safe from flooding, and 5 potential staging area locations. And here are the results from running the optimization model. The three figures describe three scenarios, scenario 1, scenario 12, and scenario 25. Across the scenarios, the mean number of demand is 1270 with the standard deviation of 355. The number of receiving hospital or the safe hospitals varies from 6 to 12, and one staging area at Houston is opened. In scenario 12, we will regenerate with the northwest direction, category 2, 5 mile per hour of the 4 speed with high tide, with the number 12 landfall location. The number of flooded hospital is maximum with 29 hospitals, whereas there are 8 hospitals in scenario 1 and 14 in scenario 25. The demand in scenario 12 is near 1580, where the other two, the demands are 550 and then 679. The six additional receiving hospitals takes patient flow in the scenario 12. As we can observe from the figure, the more locations near Houston seem to suffer from flooding, where the landfall location is near the mean crossing point, where it is close to Corpus Christi. If you see the three figures, you can see that the green dots are the sending hospitals or the evacuating hospitals. You can see that there are more green dots near the Houston for the figure in the middle. Next slide, please. In the next experiment, we expand our network and include the nursing home locations to the network. There are 153 hospitals, 673 nursing homes, and then 5 staging areas. So here we present the algorithmic method and result. Please note that we want to solve the problem in real time while preparing for the upcoming hurricane. So basically, we want to solve the problem within 10 minutes. To achieve this, we introduce three algorithmic approaches to solve the problem. In the first method, we solve the model with a solver, the commercial solver called Groby, without any heuristics. In the second approach, we use a solver by fixing staging area location decision one at a time. Simply, we take advantage of the problem structure and run the model five times with a one staging area open for each run. For the third method, we develop a greedy heuristic. Comparing the model generation and optimization time, the ARC-based formulation, as I introduced in the earlier slide, performs better than the path-based formulation. The greedy heuristic shows advantages in solving time, since the solver takes a long time to both generate and solve the model. The the objective value for the greedy heuristic is about 6% worse than the best known objective value. Next slide, please. And here are the future extensions of our research. For the flood generation methodology, we'd like to implement more accurate coastal flooding models such as SERC. And also, we want to validate our model with another hurricane instance. I mean, here we validated our model with one hurricane instance, which is Hurricane Harvey, but we want to run the model with other hurricane instances and then calibrate to improve the accuracy of the model. The uncertainty taken into account for flood scenario generation was the hurricane landfall locations only. So we'd like to account for more sources of uncertainty in hurricane forecast to enhance our model. In the optimization side, we want to implement the double trips to the current formulation because the emergency vehicles often make more than one trip to healthcare facilities to evacuating from healthcare facilities to evacuate patients within the limited time frame before hurricane landfall. We also plan to develop bear heuristics and eventually provide an end user tool to our collaborator, the Southeast Regional Advisor Council, SACTRAC, who is in charge of patient evacuation operations in Southeast Texas region. This is the end of our presentation, and thank you for listening.
Hey, thanks, y'all. Again, we'll do Q&A at the end. But if you do have a question right now, fresh, you can type it into the chat. And we'll go ahead with Catherine.
Great, thank you. And I enjoyed watching and hearing your presentation earlier as well, thank you. All right, I'm gonna share screens as well. Let's see. Okay. Great, so I'm gonna spend about 15 minutes. I'm gonna set my timer for 14. I think Jonathan's gonna keep me on track too. And I just wanted to give an overview of the Texas Metro Observatory, which is a project that's been a part of Planet Texas 2050 for 2 years now. So report out on what we've been doing, you know, why we decided to come together as a project in the first place, kind of our goals and aspirations, what projects are underway right now, kind of sub-projects, and then also talking about what's up next, which has been slightly delayed by COVID, but we're still kind of moving ahead slowly but surely. So the idea behind Texas Metro Observatory, or TMO, which I'll probably also use during this presentation, is to have a communication and data platform online that is dedicated to thinking about Texas communities, and specifically Texas's urbanized and urbanizing communities. So almost 90% of Texans live in metropolitan areas, kind of the metro areas surrounding our urban center cities throughout the state. And we really came together thinking, you know, we need a platform to kind of create more of a discourse and more attention to this phenomenon that Texas, although, you know, we have a rural legacy and that is an important part of who we are as a culture, we're also really urbanized. So the idea of this data and communication platform is a place to share information and ideas, a place to share data and data products, a place eventually to have kind of conversation and discourse about urbanization and urbanizing Texas. Oh, sorry, there we go. Yep, that's working. So over the past 2 years, we've had a great group of folks from across the university working on this project. So faculty and researchers from School of Architecture, LBJ School, and Cockrell School of Engineering, as well as students from those units, as well as a few others, and collaborators at the very beginning, and a couple big workshops that brought in a lot of stakeholders and municipal department agency folks to advise us on what this platform should be and what it could be. And we've also been working with community-powered workshop over the past few months to do an evaluation of it. So they've been a big piece of it, as well as working with ITS consulting here at UT to figure out how to get a website up when it looked like that was the direction we had to take. So I think today Fernanda is here as well. So I'm just gonna give an overview of kind of what the team's been doing, but she's also here for questions, I bet. So really what this came down to, and this is one of the original, if you guys were involved with the Bridging Barriers back in like 2017 before it was Bridging Barriers, this basically came together as one of those concept papers that faculty from across the university submitted. And really the gist here was a couple things. The first is we wanted to kind of bring attention, have a platform to bring attention to these issues of urbanized and urbanizing Texas, specifically because we're really curious about this idea of the urban inversion, which is that over time, as cities kind of emptied out in the US and more people moved into the suburbs, demographic shifts happen in response to that. And what we've been seeing in some places, and we weren't sure about what was happening in Texas, as the wealthy are moving back into central cities and displacing the poor and lower class and working class and middle class folks who've been there for a while. And what does that mean in terms of, as people are being displaced, their access to services and infrastructure in more ex-urban or suburban areas. So that was kind of the underlying kind of equity lens that we were thinking about with this project, but it kind of evolved into multiple kind of threads that came together under that umbrella. So this is Michael Oden's slide. So just kind of thinking about, yes, we have this rural past and history and legacy and a cultural importance of that rural landscape in our rural communities in Texas. But at the end of the day, almost 90% of us now live in these metropolitan areas. And here's a map from our report that we put together last year. I'm just showing these metropolitan areas across the state. It's a MSA's, a metropolitan statistical area, is a US Census Bureau term. And it's basically just trying to describe these greater areas around central cities that are connected by jobs, by our economies, by transportation, sometimes by culture. So you can see a big chunk of them right here in central Texas, kind of along the Edwards Aquifer, where we have all the water. And then as we move to the east, and then we've got some kind of clustered as we go west. So our vision was two things, that it's this platform for data sharing and data products, but also that it's we were hoping that it would be kind of a nexus to create more collaboration across the state, thinking about metropolitan research. And we started off very ambitious, but then through this workshop process the first summer, where we brought in two sets of workshop attendees to kind of kick around this idea of what we might be doing, got feedback on that, and then went out and did, and when I say we, I meant graduate research assistants, and they did a great job, went out and interviewed agency staff and elected officials in multiple metropolitan areas across the state. The feedback we got was that although this is all useful, what we should really try to focus on is starting with some research projects that really matter to the people involved, and then elaborating from there. So not trying to do everything at once, which is often what we try to do as researchers, or at least this group of people did. So scope it down to some things that we already were invested in, kind of with our minds and our hearts. And then not focus so much on trying to be this giant data repository, but focus more on providing useful data products and interactive dashboards, things like that. And what our hope is that this could be a useful tool for researchers and academic researchers, as well as K through 12 educators, state and local government staff, policymakers, nonprofit staff members, journalists, and advocates. And so far, what we've seen, it's still early data, but one example of this is we're about to hear about the Texas Virtual Realities Project. And that's researchers using some of this TMO generated data to then create this new amazing product, which we're about to see. And then we've been working with Texas Monthly on an article talking about these shifting Texas demographics and natural resources uses. So that was delayed because of COVID, but hopefully we'll pick up that thread again. So we've been able to do this in a few instances, and I hope that it continues that way. And this is kind of where our workflow. We hit the ground running that first summer with those workshops I talked about, a lot of extensive literature reviews that kept the graduate student research assistants busy. And then we decided to kind of narrow down on these research projects for the first year. And with the ultimate goal of creating this report on indicators, kind of thinking about population, demographic, resource use indicators across the state to try to give people kind of a snapshot of what life in metropolitan Texas looks like right now and how it's changed over the past 20 or 30 years. And instead of going through these, I think I'll just show you the website because these are me summarizing other people's research. I think it's more dynamic to actually look at it. So let's see if I can share again, but share this time with all right, so here it is. And my internet's a little slow because there's four of us using Zoom right now in my household, but muddle through with me. So what we've, it's basic, and right now we're going through an evaluation of it, and the idea is to get feedback on it and then elaborate it and improve it. But you can kind of see what we've been doing as far as research through two things. So this report, People, Land, and Water, that we put out last year that looks at demographic shifts over Texas, shifts in land resource use over Texas metropolitan areas, and shift in water use over Texas metropolitan areas. So that is a resource for y'all. But then the thing that's kind of fun, we also took Stephen Richter, who was our GRA on this piece of the project, took our existing research and made dashboards of it. So it's accessible, kind of those data products I was talking about. So here you can see Michael Oden's research on demographics and demographic change in Texas. So if you kind of scroll down and you can choose your MSA. So I'll be provincial, we'll choose Austin. And these are shifts in different types of demographic change. Starting in 1990 to 2016. So you can kind of see in the Austin metropolitan statistical area that we have had significant increase in population, Asian population, Hispanic population. Here at the bottom, it's divided into kind of the metro, suburban, or urban type of place in the metropolitan area. And as you look at, go across, you can look at poverty, as well as household units and education, which may not be in here, but it's in the report. And you can do it kind of slice and dice in different ways. So that's one example of kind of data products that we're serving, and kind of the take home from this demographic glimpse that Michael took of Texas was that our cities are increasingly diverse. Our cities are seeing a significant suburbanization since 1990, but there's been some glimpses of a re-urbanization over the past 5 years. So it's a little early to say if that urban inversion is happening, but there are some glimpses that maybe it is. We've seen a significant rise in suburbanization of poverty in Texas as well. So, and an increase in education levels in metropolitan residents. So those were kind of his take homes. And Stephen and I worked on water research, looking at water use across metropolitan areas in Texas. And our takeaways here, it's statewide, but you can also divvy it down by metropolitan areas. Kind of the takeaway is that the good news is that as a whole, Texan metropolitan areas have gotten more water wise over the past several decades. So we're using less water per person in our metropolitan areas, which is great. But the second part of the takeaway is that, of course, we've added lots of people to Texas and they're not bringing water with them. So our overall water use is increasing because we have more people here, even though per person we're using less water in metropolitan areas. So that was the water piece. And Stephen, and his are really cool. So this is land cover data. And here's just kind of toggling back and forth. If you can see Austin in, I think this is 2016. And the pink indicates impervious cover. So you can see just over that 15-year period, Austin has increased by impervious cover quite a bit. And the darker the pink, it's like the more impervious it is, if that makes sense. So impervious cover in an urban area really impacts our water quality, our water availability, our heat, and all sorts of other kind of environmental and health variables. So he didn't just do this for Austin, but he did it across the state, and you can fiddle around with this if you would like to see it as well. So his take home was that we have slowed our rate of use of land use, land cover expansion. So we're not Portland, Oregon by any means or measure, but overall Texas metro areas are not growing as rapidly as far as land consumption over time. And he's still kind of fiddling with that data and trying to figure out why. It started to slow down after the recession. And that's part of it, I think, you know, the 2008 recession, but it has stayed kind of slow. So we're kind of curious about that. All right, I've got about a minute and a half left, or 2 minutes. So that's some of the data products that, you know, I'll just kind of, oh, I will just mention this quickly because this is really cool too. So the other kind of four pieces of kind of this piece of the research we did last year was Dr. Patrick Bixler's work on Texas social vulnerability and Austin's climate vulnerability. So social vulnerability is both the climate vulnerability as well as social factors. And then also just looking specifically at climate vulnerability in Austin. So I'm going to stop that share and go back to my slides. Thanks for your patience. So where we are now is that, and this has been delayed by COVID, but after we launched the website last fall and put out our first report, we wanted to get feedback from communities and stakeholders and people who might use this data. Is this useful? Is this what you're envisioning to all the people that participated in those workshops and those interviews that first summer? Do we go in a totally different direction? Do we need to kind of reboot it? So that got delayed because we're going to do in-person interviews working with community powered workshop, and COVID hit. So now we're doing it virtually, and they're about to launch a survey for us maybe later on this week. I was hoping it was ready for today so I could hit you guys up to look at the website and fill it out. It's not quite ready, but that's kind of the next step. And once we get that feedback, thinking about how we incorporate that into kind of the next iteration of it. What we would like to do, what has been on our plan, and we hope we get there, is that now that we have this platform, we would really love it to be much more interactive with people living in Texas, right? So we would love to have some kind of citizen, we're calling it a citizen social scientist aspect to it, a place where people across Texas can submit requests. Hey, I'd really love data on this, or I'd really love help in mapping out this problem or this challenge or this thing I've noticed. Or in addition, a place that could be actually a place for kind of formal research interaction with communities. Having a chance to kind of look through some of these data products and start to develop almost community-led research initiatives across the state, helping Texans kind of tell that story of what life in Texas communities is like now, how it's changed from the past, and where we're kind of going towards the future. So I'll just, I'll end it with this. If you do research at all that's connected to metropolitan areas across the state, we would love to publicize it on this site. If you would like to have the data sets that we work with or use the data products, they're welcome. You guys are welcome to use them. I wish the survey is ready for you, but it's not quite, but we're gonna send it out to the network email. So hopefully you can do it then. And we're looking for future research external funding opportunities to think about the citizen social scientist opportunity. So if you're doing work along those lines and would like to join that effort, we'd love to hear from you as well. So thank you all.
Great, thank you, Catherine. Again, if you have questions, you can post them in the chat for now, and we'll hand it off to actually Danny from Danny Weeks will be presenting on the Texas Futures VR project.
Well, we have multiple people talking. Danny is going to be controlling our slides. Thanks, Danny. Hi, I'm Fernanda Leche. I'm an associate professor in the Department of Civil, Architectural, and Environmental Engineering. I'm also part of the PT 2050 Theme Organizing Committee, and I'm serving as chair for this academic year. And I'm joined here today by the team, most of the team members for the Texas Futures Virtual Reality Experience. MJ Johns from Arts and Entertainment Technology, Andrew Solis from the VizLab, which is part of the Texas Advanced Computing Center, and also two of our students involved in this project, Bing Han and Danny Weeks, who will be running our demo. And the undergrad students have class at this time, but they did share their thoughts via a little video testimonial that we'll share with you today. Danny, if you can, thank you. So the reason why this project came about within PT 2050 was really to try to think of a way of how we could engage stakeholders in a unique way, in an experiential way, and very much inspired by other PT 2050 related research like the escape room that was also experiential in nature. And so we also wanted to build a series of assets or begin building a series of assets that we could use in various engagement opportunities. And that's why we began working in this VR experience. So the overarching theme then is to really transform science into experience, to utilize research output from other PT 2050 research projects into this game that is science-based. The next slide is a picture of our team. You can see that it's we're a very cross-disciplinary team. Represent three different units within the university. And we had five different students involved in this project of various units across the university. And we'll talk a little bit about what each one did as well in the video testimonies. But the cool thing is that each one brought their expertise to the table. Slide. So we did have to shift our plans, much like what Catherine just mentioned about TMO. Ours being a physical face-to-face, the idea was to take this VR experience to engagement opportunities, and we were not able to do that because of COVID. So that led to a shift into developing online interactions as part of this the Texas Futures VR experience. And we want to make sure that this stays as a VR asset as part of the PT 2050 portfolio moving forward, but we're hoping to still be able to engage in 2021, once it's safe to do so, and deploy our actual demos and face-to-face events. MJ is also gonna talk a little bit more about how we shifted some of the work due to COVID. Slide.
Okay, thank you, Fernanda. Hi, everyone. My name is Bing Han. I'm a third-year PhD student in the civil engineering department, and I'm a graduate research assistant to this project. I'll present our VR experience along with Danny Weeks, who is also a PhD student in civil engineering. So our VR experience begins with the player in a virtual laboratory conducting population and climate change research. To begin, the player is given time to learn VR functions and operations. The player's movement in the physical world will be directly reflected in the VR environment, and they can also teleport inside the lab area. We also visualize their hands in the virtual environment. Therefore, the players can intuitively interact with gaming objects, and at the same time, they can control the progress to the next game stage by pressing a button on their virtual utility watch, just like this. After a short training, we designed a puzzle game for them to explore the interconnection among water, energy, urbanization, and ecosystems in environmental and resilience research topics. We introduce each topic by video or 3D animations. For example, you're looking at an introduction video on heat island effect. Here, we first define the term and then briefly explain the causes and impacts in the beginning of each topic. As you can see, the virtual video player is introducing heat island effect to player now. Based on our introduction and the player's knowledge, he or she will connect elements that are relevant to this topic. They activate the links by touching the icons in the virtual world and click a button on their handheld controller. We give players plenty of time for thinking and polishing their answers. After finishing an answer, the players submit their answer and then they can get visual feedback on whether their connections match the connections found in the research. At the end of each topic, we give a thorough explanation on the correct answer by video. There are four research topics that users will work on in this puzzle game, including heat island effect, disease, air pollution, and imperviousness. We intentionally increase the difficulty of the game because in this game, communicating knowledge on the four topics is not our only objective. More importantly, we hope to arouse the curiosity of users and inspire them to continue this exploration after the VR experience. Therefore, we challenge the players with less and less information in the introduction and increase the visual effects of game objects to keep their attention at the same game, at the same time. Now the player is finishing air pollution and moving to the last task, imperviousness. The introduction to the topic is a well-structured 3D animation. So here, players need to carefully compare the difference between the effects of urban and rural area under heavy rain to understand the topic and get their correct answer. Our playtest shows that the combination of this attractive format and challenging nature of the game serve our purpose well. So now I will hand it over to Danny and he will continue introducing the other part of our game. Thank you.
Thank you, Bing. Appreciate that. And as the player finishes up their last activity on the puzzle activity and they put it away, they're able to spend a little time looking around the lab and transitioning from the puzzle activity to the map activity. And as they do so, they're able to glance at the wall and notice some of the products that we have. And these are actual data products that come from our data sources, where normally you would present in a paper or on a poster. And our hope by presenting this as an interactive game, that we're able to make the findings more memorable and to reach a wider audience, everything from high schoolers all the way up through Texas lawmakers and policymakers, to bring home the lessons of the research. To help with the immersion of the lab, we teamed up with a graphic designer who you'll hear from here in a little bit, Lori, to increase the realism of the lab and give that user the feeling of immersion. So the player will move into position in front of the Texas Futures map and activate it with their button. And the objective of this activity is to present population and water usage data for 17 of the major metropolitan areas here in Texas from the TMO data. You can see that the map started in 1990, and as the player moves the slider up to 2050, you'll see an increase in population with each full bar representing 1 million people in that metro area, and the colors represent the density, with red being the most dense. As the player pushes the show water button, they're gonna see now data for water usage for those same 17 metro areas. And just like before, as they move the slider from 2020 up to 2050, you see the water increase as the research found water increase happens. But what the lower slider does is allows the player to see the impact to water reduction by implementing different strategies. And the two strategies we've highlighted is demand reduction or simply using less water and then water reuse. And so as the player toggles between these two options, they can see the reduction in water use. So for the final stage of the game, the player will place this orb over their head, and they're going to be transported to a Texas street here in 2020. What we want to do is immerse the player in a somewhat familiar environment, kind of looking at how the infrastructure, particularly a street, is able to handle the population of today. But as they place the next orb over their head, they're going to be transported to a Texas street in 2050 and really immersed in the environment of a more dense and a higher population area. And you can see with the mix of cars and bikes and people on the street, there is more strain on the infrastructure. One note about the player feedback here is this was originally shot as a 360-degree video, but the players complained of motion sickness, so it was reshot or edited to be stills. As the player places the orb on their head, they're taken to our acknowledgments. And with that, I'm going to hand over the next portion of this presentation to two of our undergraduate research assistants, Lori and Jeshua. And based on playtesting, I have a question. Can everybody hear Jeshua?
We cannot.
No. Okay. So sorry about that. I will quickly reconfigure because I didn't share my screen properly.
Hello, Planet Texas 2050. My name is Jeshua Johnson. I am a senior majoring in arts and entertainment technologies here at UT. As a designer and programmer for the Texas Futures VR experience, I learned new methods to visualize data and create an educational experience through interactive media. As a native Texan, I've watched as the weather sets records year after year. I think this project and future projects like it are ever more crucial to help the general public understand the impact and challenges of our ecosystems for years to come. Hello.
Hello, I'm Lori Van Hoos, a sophomore at UT Austin. I first joined this project whenever I met Bing and Jeshua at the VR Game Jam hosted for my major, Art and Entertainment Technology. I have used my skills to create a room layout and most of the model's materials and textures inside the room. I also created some of the animations you'll see in the game. I love being able to work on this VR game with this friendly and understanding team. Working on this game and with this team has allowed me to create a more efficient art pipeline for creating game objects and overall improve my skills in texturing, modeling, UV mapping, and more. This game will not only help me, it will also help others learn about the problems in Texas in a more fun and interactive way. Hello.
Hey everyone, I'm MJ and I'm gonna talk a little bit about how we playtested this experience. So at the beginning of this project, we had always intended that we would show our VR experience to the public to receive feedback and make improvements. When the pandemic hit and moved everything online, we had to adapt to organizing remote playtests. And one of the biggest challenges with this is because it's a VR experience, we had to rely on playtesters who already had access to VR equipment. If we had been able to host the playtest in person, we would have been able to set up equipment ourselves. But due to being online, we relied on finding playtesters from the local VR community, as well as students and members of the Planet Texas 2050 community who had access to that equipment. At a live event, we would also have been able to observe what our playtesters were doing, and this is a valuable aspect of playtesting to get feedback. But to adapt to that, we ended up collecting some data during the experience by tracking things like how long users took to complete certain parts of the activities. This allowed us to identify places where the users were getting stuck or having trouble. We also collected feedback using a survey, and some of the useful feedback we received was that helped us improve our experience and the usability was feedback on the help and next buttons, which were previously placed on the table, and we adapted them to be on the user's wrist as the watch, which you saw in the video. We also moved the exit button from it being placed on the table to being on the door to make it a little bit more intuitive that you would use the door to exit the experience. And that was also when we got the feedback on the 360-degree video that it was causing some motion sickness, and so we adapted the 360 video based on that feedback as well. And another aspect of the data that we collected was how the users felt towards the scientific data after participating. And we found that 66% of users were interested in continuing to learn more about climate change after participating in the experience. On the next slide, I'm going to talk a little bit about the papers that we've had our research accepted for. So the first is the Journal of Design and Creative Technologies, which will have a paper published called The Transformative Power of Games, which is broadly about how games can be used to bring about meaningful change. And this project is used as one of the examples in that paper. The second one is using immersive technology to increase awareness, which would be presented at the Texas Resilience Conference, which has been rescheduled for next year. And then the third one is being co-authored by our two grad students, Danny and Bing, which is sustainability research representation in virtual reality, which they hope to publish in the Journal of Civil Engineering Education. And next, Andrew is going to talk about our engagement and events.
Thank you, MJ. Good afternoon, everyone. Over the course of this project, we participated in multiple engagement events to not only promote our work, but for a broader discussion of using climate science to create narrative and interactive experiences. This includes community events such as Thinkery 21 to promote some previous work, as well as plans for a discussion at South by Southwest 2020 for transforming science into immersive experiences. With COVID, some of these events have been postponed or changed, and the South by Southwest one was sadly canceled, but we've also submitted a proposal for South by Southwest 2021 for a similar discussion panel. And we've also promoted this work at conferences, both local and national, like MJ has stated previously. Our plan is for these continued submissions in the future for future conferences and community events, as well as having a permanent installation of our demo at the Texas Advanced Computing Center inside the VizLabs. Our hope is that this gives us the opportunity not only to promote our work, but also gather feedback and reach out to the wider community as well. Yeah, and that's it for our presentation. Thank you very much for giving us this opportunity, and we welcome any discussion or any questions anyone may have.
Cool. Thanks, everyone. So we have a few minutes. It looks like maybe the breakout rooms isn't totally flying as a concept this time. But if you want to go ahead and just ask some questions to any of our presenters, go ahead and just raise your hand.
Catherine, I'm curious to hear your reaction of seeing the TMO data in VR now, the final product, because you haven't seen the final product. You hadn't seen the final product before. You're muted.
I clicked on the breakout room to see. Oh dear. I've got two computers going. Okay. The sound on my other computer is on. I have to figure out how to turn it off. I'm sorry. Fernanda, I will come back to your question.
I think I can.
I have a question for the flood modeling team, if I may. You mentioned that one of your big stakeholders is an actual agency who handles evacuations during hurricanes. Have you briefed them on some of your findings, and are they adopting this actual modeling technique for future hurricanes?
We have presented our model to them, and it was before COVID. Yeah, they're also taking care of this COVID situation on their own. So I think they're the hot topic right now is of COVID. But we hope that we implement our approach, and then we want to develop some kind of a web-based tool for them. So our effort doesn't go in vain.
But I've been in kind of regular meetings with folks at C-Track on a regular basis. Is that right?
Yes. We have.
Fernanda, I just wanted to circle back. It was really cool to see. We saw the prototype earlier this year, but I'm really excited that you guys are had it at the Thinkery as well. I just love that idea of engaging that age group. So yeah, it's really wonderful to see it come to life. So congratulations.
It was definitely, and I've mentioned this before in other PT 2050 events, this was definitely one of the most fun projects that I've ever been involved in at UT.
I have a question. I'm curious to know from the VR team if you had if there were any surprising applications you had not expected, or that you've had people ask you about from other fields or other members of the PG 2050 network or beyond in the engagement that you've had publicly or online. Just curious to know if any like really surprising opportunities have come up or ideas that are way out there.
MJ, do you want to take that related to the playtest?
Sorry, could you repeat the question one more time? I missed just the beginning of it.
Yeah, basically if there have been any particularly unique requests for how you might apply this work in other fields or with other groups.
I work pretty closely with VR Austin, which is the local VR organization, and VR Austin as an organization is really interested in like more crossover between VR in general with other areas besides entertainment, because VR can be really broadly applicable to a lot of different things. And so like there are groups here in Austin that are working on VR experiences for like different aspects of education and like science and training and health and medical things as well. And so I think the kind of work that we're doing on this project does open up some doors to other kinds of crossover opportunities that we have.
Andrew, do you want to add anything from the VisLabs perspective?
Yeah, so I think especially for us, we're always looking at ways for integrating virtual reality or some of these more immersive technologies on how we can help scientists understand their data sets. So kind of creating new and innovative ways for them to view their data than the more traditional ways of viewing it like on a 2D screen. So in a smaller sense, just collaborating with Fernanda and MJ has already opened up the possibility of us kind of like continuing these sort of collaborations, but also a wider discussion on how this technology can be used for helping scientists who say use our systems to better understand their data. So it's really interesting to see like where this is going to go moving forward and how we can hopefully integrate that with some of TAC's available resources.
Thank you.
And I was just gonna add that from my perspective, trying to really understand how the coding behind the scenes in the VR environment impacted how we were displaying and having users visualize our data in the VR environment in a unique way, because I was learning a lot along the way with NJ, with Andrew, on the limits, trying to push the limits of interaction in the VR environment. With the kind of data that we had. So playing around with what's more intuitive, sometimes it's not like the complete data, but it becomes more intuitive if we show it in a certain way and we enable users to interact with it in a certain way. And that way, in a way, sometimes less is more when you don't overwhelm the users with too much information and you really think about how they're going to interact with the data. So for me, it was a really cool exercise of of how to extract, you know, just the key parts of the data to make the interaction more meaningful and more intuitive for the users. Jonathan, we're not doing breakouts anymore?
Oh, nobody's signed up for them. Okay. So I guess it seems a small enough group that it wasn't necessary. And also it seemed like there was a lot of projects that maybe having the questions cross between the projects was potentially more fruitful. I had a question for Catherine, actually. I was wondering what the possibilities were for having data in metropolitan areas that are more fine-grained, like at a neighborhood scale, zip code scale, you know, like a lot of inequities and things like that, like show up more readily, like at those smaller scales. And I was wondering what would it take, or what would there be possibilities for those sorts of data sets to be part of the TMO?
Yeah, that's a good question, Jonathan. I'm just gonna check. I think the smallest spatial scale we get to on these particular projects is the census tract. Census block group. And really this is just determined by kind of the feedback we got that first summer was just, you can't do it all, just focus on everyone's kind of love and area of expertise and then hone down on that and then have something concrete to present. Since we were trying to go across the state, I think, and hit all those 25 metropolitan statistical areas and a lot of this research, we kind of sacrifice the finer grained glimpse, just because it's hard to juggle that amount, just what Fernando was saying about just kind of curating presentation of data. But I think, you know, certainly probably a great fit would be thinking about the Austin climate vulnerability work, right, that Patrick's been doing. And I'll just quickly, I don't know if I need to show it, but I can. Here you can kind of see it's at the, this is not my normal computer, so it's a little bit hard to come back in and out. It's finer grain scale than some of the other stuff we've been doing. So I think, I mean, to answer your question specifically, it's just kind of depending on next steps as far as research products. So, you know, if we end up finding more external funding to kind of continue this work and someone has interest in doing it a little bit more finely grained, then that would be great. And kind of be the path forward on that.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
And maybe the way to kind of that cross section, which is what we're trying to do across the state, just kind of tell the story of this is life in Austin, but this is also happening in El Paso, and maybe it's happening in Houston. Maybe if you want to get finer scaled at the neighborhood block level, then just kind of picking a neighborhood from each of the 25 metropolitan areas and like comparing across, that'd be kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm. Catherine, I like what you said in reflection about how your team adapted from initially you wanting to have just a large data platform and then pivoting towards more of a data products mentality. I don't know if you want to say any more about how you made that decision or how users are potentially using the data products now. But I thought that was really, really interesting.
Yeah, kind of reoccurring story with Planet Texas 2050. We go really big and it's hard to get it done. So we went really big with our initial kind of conception of it, and the feedback we got was like, hey, you know, that's just maybe just focus on the product piece. That there's lots of, you know, if you're a researcher, you know where to get those data sets already. And if you're a journalist, you don't want the data necessarily. You want kind of a product that helps you tell the story, or you want to interact with the researcher that helps you find that right product. So that was the advice we followed. And I think the other piece of it, just the practicality of keeping a data repository updated, you know, every year as new data comes in, was more than we could afford with, you know, our budget. We didn't have the staff time to do it. So we have talked in the past, and it's kind of on the back burner, but is that something like we automate it, working with TAC, with DataX? But right now we don't seem to have any demand for it. Like, no one has emailed us on TMO through the website and said, hey, I really want the data set, you know? So that's one of the reasons we're doing this evaluation right now. And that's one of the questions we're asking is that, okay, you know, this is the way we've kind of framed it. We could also go in this other direction. Would that be of interest or of use to anyone? So that was kind of the back and forth discussion on it, but it is something that keeps coming up. So I think, especially as academic researchers, we're kind of like in the weeds of the data. We kind of want to, I think part of our heart still wants it to be a data repository, but this seemed both more useful and more manageable. And I think what my takeaway was just, you know, it's really cool to see the virtual realities videos today, and then the other project, kind of applied project we've been working on the article with Texas Monthly. What was interesting with that was that even the data products weren't digested enough for them, if that makes sense. They also wanted additional kind of interpretation from us about what the data effects meant. So it was like another layer of explanation around it that seemed to be what they were looking for. So that's something else I'm curious about from this upcoming survey. If it's, you know, the dashboards work for lots of people, but maybe they don't work for everyone or don't work for certain user groups, you know, that need something that's presented in a different way, which is kind of looping back to Fernanda's point about just the stories we choose to tell with data and how we kind of package the story and make it more accessible. So yeah, great question.
I have a question about the Texas Metro Observatory. So I know you mentioned a lot about like the urbanization. So is green infrastructure something that you'll be focusing on in the future, or is that like, are you planning on focusing on that in like some of your research?
Yeah, thank you for that question. I mean, right now, how it is how we structure the early research projects of Plan Texas 2050 is that they had 1 or 2 years of funding, and then you're expected to be able to self-fundraise for continuation. So we're done with Plan Texas 2050 funding for TMO. So right now, I think what we're focusing on is this evaluation, and then thinking about this other kind of, you know, kind of co-produced research project that we would like to do, which is the citizen social science aspect of it. But certainly more topic area research would be really interesting. And I do some green infrastructure work, and so does Patrick Bixler. So that would be a great place to move into. And I think any work that we do, I have an article that's about to go back out, a co-published article, co-authored article that's about to go back out for second review on a National Tree Planting Initiative survey, thinking about kind of the urban greening of urban forests, and a piece of that data relates to Texas. So anytime anything like that comes up, we'll post it. But it would be cool to have one of those tabs in the dashboards be green infrastructure across the state. And then just even thinking about how would we create the metrics for that, right? And the fact that, like, no, I don't think any Texas city yet has a green infrastructure plan. So just thinking about, you know, using land cover data. So no plans right now immediately for that kind of across the state, all 25 metropolitan areas, looking at a single topic area of green infrastructure. But it would certainly be something we'd love to do if we could work it into some other kind of funding opportunity. So, yeah, thanks.
Thank you.
I would just add quickly to that, Catherine and Fernanda, that there's some opportunity in your next work that you're collaborating on, potentially related to green infrastructure, right? But in some of the future work that Planet Texas is planning.
Great. Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Dave. That Fernanda and I are in the midst of creating a work plan for this new four-year project focused on resilient, equitable urban features in Texas. And although we haven't committed yet explicitly to looking at every of the 25 metropolitan areas across the state, because we're still kind of scoping it, we are using the framework of thinking about kind of the built and the environmental landscapes or environments. So I hate to say natural environment because I think humans are natural too. So it's always, what word do we use? But kind of the built environment and the green environment, and green infrastructure will be a piece of that for sure. But I think at least we haven't decided yet exactly how we're gonna scale that across the state and what cities we're looking at. But that's a good point. And I would love to, research projects that come out of that flagship, I would love to just post up on TMO just to kind of keep material current up there.
We'll have the opportunity this afternoon, Catherine, to brainstorm a bit in our retreat.
That's great. Time to make decisions. Yeah.
Any other questions? Or Catherine, go ahead. I heard a voice. Well, thanks everyone for presenting or for being here. We've been doing this every couple of weeks. We're gonna go on a bit of a hiatus, and then our iteration of the Planet Texas 2050 showcase will actually be in December, and we're gonna have kind of a sprint in a way. We'll have both December 1st and 2nd, December 8th and 9th during the lunch hour like this. But thanks for attending. Thanks to all the presenters. And we'll be following up with the recording, and if any other information that's relevant, like the survey, and have a great rest of your day.
Thanks, Jonathan. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks everyone.
Thanks everyone for joining us.
Thanks everyone.
Bye everyone.